Welcome back to your social science class. Today we'll be continuing the same chapter, The Making of the National Movement 1870s to 1947. So now let's begin the chapter. The role at Satyagraha. In 1919, Gandhiji gave a call for a satyagraha against the Rowlatt Act that the British had just passed. The act curbed fundamental rights such as freedom of expression and strengthened police powers. Mahatma Gandhi, Muhammad Ali Jinnah and others felt that the government had no right to restrict people's basic freedom. They criticized the act as devilish. Gandhiji asked the Indian people to observe 6th April 1919 as the day of non-violent opposition to this act, as the day of humiliation and prayer and hartal, that is, strike. Satyagraha Sabhas was set up to launch the movement. The Rowlatt Satyagraha turned out to be the first all-India struggle against the British government, although it was largely restricted to cities. In April 1919, there were a number of demonstrations and hartals in the country, and the government used brutal measures to suppress them. The Jallianwala Bagh atrocities inflicted by General Dyer in Amritsar on Baisakhi Day, 13th April, were a part of this repression. On learning about the massacre, Rabindranath Tagore expressed the pain and anger of the country by renouncing his knighthood. Okay, students, now let me explain you about the Jallianwala Bagh atrocities. In fact, the tragedy of Jallianwala Bagh occurred in 1919 AD on the Baisakhi Day. The people of Amritsar were holding a meeting in Jallianwala Bagh on that day to protest against the arrest of their leaders. General Dyer, one of the British officials, without giving any warning, ordered his troops to fire on the peaceful meeting. As a result, many people were killed. So, a wave of discontent and anger spread all over the country, resulting to which even Rabindranath Tagore expressed his pain and anger and renounced his knighthood. During the Rowlatt Satyagraha, the participants tried to ensure that Hindus and Muslims were united in all fight against the British rule. This was also the call of Mahatma Gandhi, who always saw India as a land of all the people who lived in the country, whether it be Hindus, Muslims, or those of other religions. He was keen that Hindus and Muslims support each other in any just cause. Now let's study about the Khilafat agitation and the non-cooperation movement. The Khilafat issue was one such cause. In 1920, the British imposed a harsh treaty on the Turkish Sultan or Khilafah. People were furious about this as they had been about the Jallianwala Bagh massacre. Also, Indian Muslims were keen that the Khilafah be allowed to retain control over Muslim sacred places in the erstwhile Ottoman Empire. The leaders of the Khilafat agitation, Muhammad Ali and Shaukat Ali, now wished to initiate a full-fledged non-cooperation movement. Gandhiji supported the call and urged the Congress to campaign against the Punjab wrongs, which means the Jallianwala Bagh massacre, the Khilafat wrong and demand Swaraj. The non-cooperation movement gained momentum through 1921 to 22. Thousands of students left government-controlled schools and colleges. Many lawyers such as Motilal Nehru, C. R. Das, C. Rajagopalachari and Asaf Ali gave up their practices. British titles were surrendered and legislatures boycotted. People lit public bonfires of foreign cloth. The imports of foreign cloth fell drastically between 1920 and 1922. But all this was merely the tip of the iceberg. Large parts of the country were on the brink of a formidable revolt. Now let's see, what were the initiatives that the people of India during that time took? In many cases, people resisted British rule non-violently. In others, different classes and groups interpreting Gandhiji's call in their own manner protested in ways that were not in accordance with his ideas. In either case, people linked their movement to local grievances. In Kheda, Gujarat, Patidhar peasants organized non-violent campaigns against the high land revenue demand of the British. In coastal Andhra and interior Tamil Nadu, liquor shops were picketed. In the Guntur district of Andhra Pradesh, tribals and poor peasants staged a number of forest satyagrahas, sometimes sending their cattle into forests without paying grazing fee. They were protesting because the colonial state had restricted the use of forest resources in various ways. They believed that Gandhiji would get their taxes reduced and have the forest regulations abolished. In many forest villages, peasants proclaimed Swaraj and believed that Gandhi Raj was about to be established. In Sindh, now in Pakistan, Muslim traders and peasants were also very enthusiastic about the Khilafat call. In Bengal too, the Khilafat Non-Cooperation Alliance gave enormous communal unity and strength to the national movement. In Punjab, the Akali agitation of the Sikhs sought to remove corrupt Mahants supported by the British from their Gurudwaras. Now, Mahants means religious functionaries of Sikh Gurudwaras. This movement got closely identified with the non-cooperation movement. In Assam, tea garden laborers shouting, Gandhiji Maharaj Ki Jai demanded a big increase in their wages. They left the British-owned plantations amidst declarations that they were following Gandhiji's wish. Interestingly, in the Assamese Vaishnava song of the period, the reference to Krishna was substituted by Gandhi Raja, the people's Mahatma. We can see from the above that sometimes people thought of Gandhiji as a kind of Masiha, as someone who could help them overcome their misery and poverty. Gandhiji wished to build class unity, not class conflict. Yet, peasants could imagine that he would help them in their fight against zamindars and agricultural laborers, believed he would provide them land. At times, ordinary people credited Gandhiji with their own achievement. For instance, at the end of powerful movement, peasants of Pratapgarh in Uttar Pradesh managed to stop illegal eviction of tenants, but they felt it was Gandhiji who had won this demand for them. At other times, using Gandhiji's names, tribals and peasants undertook actions that did not conform to Gandhian ideals. Now, let's study about the happenings of 1922 to 1929. That means what happened between these period. Mahatma Gandhi, as you know, was against violent movements. He abruptly called off the non-cooperation movement when in February 1922, a crowd of peasants set a fire to a station in Chauri Chaura. 22 policemen were killed on that day. The peasants were provoked because the police had fired on their peaceful demonstrations. Once the non-cooperation movement was over, Gandhiji's followers stressed that Congress must undertake constructive work in the rural areas. Other leaders such as Chittaranjan Das and Motilal Nehru argued that the party should fight elections to the council and enter them in order to influence government policies. Though, through sincere social work in villages in the mid-1920s, the Gandhians were also able to extend their support base. This proved to be very useful in launching the civil disobedience movement in 1930. Two important developments of the mid-1920s were the formation of Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangha, that is the RSS, a Hindu organization, and the Communist Party of India. These parties have held very different ideas about the kind of country India should be. The revolutionary nationalist Bhagat Singh too was active in this period. The decade closed with the Congress resolving to fight for Purna Swaraj, that means complete independence, in 1929 under the presidentship of Jawaharlal Nehru. Consequently, Independence Day was observed on 26 January 1930 all over the country. This is all we have for today. We'll be continuing with the same chapter in our next class. Till then, stay home, stay safe.